Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Accidental Ecosystem, People and Wildlife in American Cities, by Peter S. Alagona, narrated by Matt Godfrey. Preface. One bright winter day several years ago, I packed up my things, changed my clothes, hopped on my bike, and headed home from work. It was a Friday, and I thought I deserved an early start to the weekend. I had just put the finishing touches on my first book, which had consumed almost a decade of my life, and I was ready for something new. For now, though, I was content to take the afternoon off. The bike path heading home leads out of my campus, past a beach, alongside a freeway, across wetlands, and then around several small farms before winding its way through sleepy suburbs and into a bustling downtown. About a mile from my office, the path meets up with Atascadero Creek. Atascadero is a lovely word for an unlovable place. In Spanish, it means something like quagmire, and this sad little stream lives up to its name. Unnaturally straight, it parallels a gravel road, looking less like a creek than like a canal. Long sections have been lined with concrete to control flash floods. On most days, though, it flows lazily, with tepid pools as black as asphalt and murky runoff trickling over slimy green rocks. 15 minutes into my ride, I crossed a bridge over the creek and turned east between a subdivision and a golf course. That was when, about 100 yards in front of me, something unusual loped across the path. It was the size of a small dog, but it had a tiny round head, big pointy ears, cartoonishly oversized haunches, and paws that, from a distance, looked as flat and wide as dinner plates. As I coasted forward, I ticked off a list of suspects. Deer? No. Raccoon? No. Skunk? No. Coyote? Probably not. Dog? Maybe. House cat? It was too big, but it had moved like one. When I reached the spot where I thought I had seen the critter, I stopped my bike and peered into the bushes. There, sitting no more than 15 feet away from me, was a bobcat, stout and full-grown, with a plush speckled coat, bright green eyes, and trademark tufted ears. This cat was in its prime. Staring back at me, it looked as big as a lion, though I knew that most bobcats weigh less than 20 pounds. We locked eyes for several seconds. Two mammals in the ancient act of sizing each other up. I'd seen bobcats in the wild twice before. The first time was just after daybreak, on a crisp fall morning, along the shore of an alpine lake in the High Sierra. That mottled gray cat blended perfectly into her granite backdrop. The second time was on a warm summer evening, on a ranch in the hills above Monterey. This second cat, with tawnier fur to match her golden-brown surroundings, paused on a grassy hilltop and glanced over her shoulder at me before disappearing into the brush. Despite my previous encounters with bobcats, or perhaps because of them, this third one came as a surprise, and then as a revelation. I was surprised because I had always pictured bobcats only in the kinds of wild places where I'd seen them before. I was even more surprised to learn that my sighting was nothing special. With a range that spans temperate and subtropical North America, bobcats thrive in a dizzying variety of habitats, from Florida's Everglades to Quebec's North Woods to Mexico's Sonoran Desert. They prefer to avoid people, but because most of their favorite foods, including rodents and other small mammals, don't, bobcats often end up in or around suburbs. Many of my friends and colleagues had seen them before in my hometown. Apparently, I was one of the last to know they were there. The revelation came next. I had spent the previous decade studying endangered species, creatures that almost by definition most people never get to see. And yet here was this wild predator, as bold and beautiful and fearsome from a certain point of view, as any Kodiak bear or Bengal tiger, prowling the Southern California suburbs. In the days that followed, I began to think a lot more about wildlife in cities. You can thank that bobcat for this book. I also realized that I had reproduced a larger pattern. For decades, most scientists and conservationists shunned urban areas and the creatures that inhabited them, focusing instead on rarer species in more remote areas. People who cared about wildlife considered cities artificial, destructive, and boring. There was little to be learned from such places, and even less to be salvaged or nurtured within them. Only recently had wildlife advocates become interested in urban areas. It took them, like me, a long time to start looking. But when they finally did, also like me, they were amazed by what they found. In the years after my encounter with that bobcat on the bike path, whenever I told anyone I was studying urban wildlife, what I got in response, without fail, was a story. What made that encounter so remarkable, I came to learn while writing this book and listening to all of those stories, was not that it was so unusual, but that it was so common. My goal in the chapters that follow is to explain both how we got to this point and what it means that just about every resident of every American city now has their own wildlife story. Introduction. Where the wild things are now. This book is about an ecosystem that was never supposed to exist. Since the first cities emerged in the Middle East several thousand years ago, every great thinker who has studied them, from Plato to Voltaire to Jane Jacobs, has agreed on one thing. Cities are for people. A handful of hardy wildlife species have always thrived in urban areas, but most were driven out as cities grew bigger and denser. Domesticated animals once roamed city streets in great numbers. But most of these, too, were eventually removed or brought under control, herded into the countryside, or ushered into human homes. By the mid-20th century, fewer animals than ever before lived in the world's most developed cities. This arrangement started to seem natural, and there was every reason to believe it would continue. Then, beginning around 1970, people living in cities in Europe, North America, parts of East Asia, and elsewhere noticed a strange new trend. Wild animals that had not been seen there for decades, or in some cases, ever, were showing up in the least likely of urban environments. Conservationists called these creatures flukes, or described them as the last gasps of a natural world choked by smog and buried under concrete. Yet the sightings continued. Soon, hardly a week was going by without a report of a new species in a new city. By 2020, no one who had seen a deer graze on a suburban lawn, an alligator plunge into a golf course pond, a hawk devour a pigeon in an urban park, a bear pluck apples from a neighbor's tree, or a seal sunbathe on a busy dock could deny that cities were filling up with wildlife. Even as wildlife populations inside cities have thrived, outside cities, many have collapsed. Since 1970, global wildlife populations have declined by an average of 60%. North America has lost 30% of its birds. Some iconic species once considered secure, from giraffes to elephants, are now threatened. Vast swaths of wildland habitat have been cleared, graded, plowed, or paved. At least 1 million species are in danger of extinction. Why have so many cities, the most artificial and human-dominated of all Earth's ecosystems, grown rich with wildlife, even as wildlife has faded from most of the rest of the world? And what does this paradox mean for cities, people, wildlife, and nature on our increasingly urban planet? The accidental ecosystem tells the story of how American cities filled with wildlife. It argues that although cities were not built with the goal of attracting wild animals, they have become rich wildlife habitats, or even weird wildlife refuges, because of decisions people made often decades ago and mostly for other reasons. The recent explosion of wildlife in American cities is one of the greatest ecological success stories since the dawn of conservation, but it happened largely by accident. Only over the past generation have scientists, conservationists, planners, and civic leaders throughout the United States begun to study, grapple with, and appreciate cities as fertile ecosystems housing diverse, multi-species communities. But bringing these animals back was the easy part. The hard part, and the real work ahead of us, is living with them now that they're here. Ecologists and conservationists were slow to grasp the changes that brought so much wildlife to so many American cities. Over the past few decades, however, as interest in urban wildlife and ecosystems has grown, two schools of thought have emerged. Let's call these two groups the skeptics and the cheerleaders. According to the skeptics, cities are mostly agents of destruction. Cities replace diverse native creatures with a small number of tough exotic species that can multiply in the company of humans, sometimes rising to the level of pests, but not contributing much to the world. Even beyond their boundaries, cities gobble up resources, laying waste to natural habitats. As this process unfolds, our planet grows more uniform and less interesting. Urban wildlife may be useful for educating the public and raising its support for conservation in more pristine areas, but cities and most of the creatures that inhabit them are of little ecological value compared with what they destroy. The cheerleaders respond that cities are novel ecosystems, which provide crucial services such as pollination, storm protection, and water filtration for the people who live in them. Cities house diverse wildlife, including hundreds of endangered and migratory species. Creatures that prosper in cities are marvels of adaptation and resilience, worthy of our respect. Since urban environments are harbingers of the future on a planet increasingly shaped by human action, we should embrace them, learn from them, and cultivate them in all their weedy glory. This book, which concludes that we should value and foster urban wildlife even when living with it poses real challenges, draws insight and inspiration from both the skeptics and the cheerleaders. Instead of taking a side, it tells the story of how we got to a point where we can have such a debate, and what this debate says not only about wildlife, but also about us. Any book about urban wildlife must begin by defining two terms, urban and wildlife, both of which are slipperier than they may at first seem. Cities exert a lopsided influence on local and global ecosystems. By 2020, only around 2% of the Earth's ice-free land surface was covered with urban areas. But many cities were booming, particularly in Africa and Asia, and together they already housed more than 56% of the world's human population. In the United States, around 83% of people lived in urban areas, including nearly 95% of residents in California, the most urban U.S. state. Cities occupy a small fraction of our planet's land base, but because they contain so many people, they consume vast quantities of resources and produce immense volumes of waste. Yet what counts as a city has changed over time. As late as the 1940s, the U.S. Census defined urban as comprising all territory, people, and housing units in incorporated places of 2,500 or more residents. In 1950, the Census Bureau introduced the term urbanized area, which now includes any contiguous zone with a population of at least 50,000 and a density of 1,000 or more residents per square mile. The Bureau defines a metropolitan statistical area as a larger region containing at least one urbanized area, plus its surrounding county and any outlying counties that meet certain criteria. Researchers outside the Bureau have developed other ways of defining cities. For example, by using satellite imagery to map the proportion of built and paved land versus green space in an urban region. For wildlife, it is best to think of the term urban as representing a continuum. Downtown, people are everywhere. Most surfaces are paved, and only a few hardy wildlife species linger for very long. Suburbs contain fewer people per square mile, tend to be leafier, and offer greater opportunities for creatures that can avoid the hazards cities pose while tapping the riches cities offer. On the outskirts, in areas known as urban wildland interfaces, diverse species benefit from a Goldilocks combination of refuge and resources. An urban satellite area may be dozens or even hundreds of miles from its parent city, but the two places are intimately connected. A dam, built to supply a distant metropolis with power and water, for example, both shapes the city and transforms the watershed. Some places that few people consider urban, including tourist magnets such as Yosemite Valley, also possess many of the features typically associated with cities, from trash dumps to traffic jams. Finally, there are urban waterways. We tend to equate cities with land, but from New York Harbor to San Francisco Bay to the Florida Everglades, urbanization has rearranged aquatic habitats on a massive scale, even if these changes can be hard to perceive for a bipedal primate. This book focuses on vertebrate wildlife, including birds, mammals, fish, and a few reptiles. Insects, arachnids, and other diminutive creatures play important supporting roles in urban ecosystems. Yet, they play only bit parts in this story, because of limited space and because we still know so little about them, including trends in their population over time. The chapters that follow also contain relatively little about some of the most familiar urban wildlife species. Squirrels make an early debut, but crows, pigeons, rats, skunks, opossums, and raccoons remain backstage. Most of the starring roles in this drama go to creatures like bald eagles, black bears, and sea lions, large and charismatic species that few would have expected 50 or 100 years ago to thrive in urban spaces. Their presence in some modern American cities reminds us both how little we knew about them decades ago and how much more we still have to learn. There are some things we may never know. One of the great ironies of ecological science is that we know so little about the places where most of us live. For decades, most ecologists ignored urban wildlife, missing opportunities to collect baseline data and monitor growing populations. Over the past generation, however, our understanding of urban ecosystems has grown in leaps and bounds. But because scientists got such a late start, there are many questions about the past that we lack the data to answer in a statistically satisfying way. There are a few exceptions to this rule, most notably regarding birds, which legions of admirers have followed in cities for more than a century. But birds are a special case. This book combines historical and scientific records with interviews and field observations to assemble a story of change over time. When you start talking with people about urban wildlife, one thing becomes clear. People who encounter these animals, which these days means almost anyone who lives in a city, invariably make meaning of the experience. Clichés portraying urban animals as diseased menaces, criminal gangs, swarthy immigrants, gritty hustlers, faithful servants, good neighbors, upstanding citizens, icons of resilience, or wellsprings of hope, have always said more about the people expressing them than they do about the creatures they claim to describe. Consider the example of native versus exotic species. Exotic species are, after habitat destruction, the second greatest driver of global biodiversity loss. Distinguishing between natives and exotics sometimes makes sense, particularly for newly introduced species. In cities, however, this distinction often breaks down. If cities are novel ecosystems, the oldest of which in North America date back only hundreds of years, then although some species may have adapted to living in them, no species is native to them in any deep ecological or evolutionary sense. Cities exist in regions with native species that may pass through or settle down in developed areas. Cities also contain newcomers, some of which cause problems, but others of which have found benign or even beneficial niches. Drawing a bright line between those that belong and those that don't, based solely on their ancestors' places of origin, raises the specter of xenophobia. It is unwarranted and, since one of the goals of studying urban wildlife is to engage a younger, more diverse constituency for conservation, it is unwise. The story of wildlife in American cities has unfolded differently in different places. One common theme is that in every place there have been winners and losers. Although cities may be sanctuaries for some creatures, they are traps for others. This book focuses mainly on the winners, species that possess some quality, such as fecundity, flexibility, or fearlessness, that has enabled them to flourish in urban environments. But for every species in this book that has thrived, many more not covered here have dwindled in or disappeared from our cities. Managers charged with protecting struggling creatures in pockets of urban habitat have some of the toughest jobs in conservation. Coexisting with wildlife means not only celebrating the charismatic species that most people like, but also treating common species that most people don't like humanely, while giving those that are struggling the space and resources they need. The time has come to start making more and better decisions with all of these creatures in mind. Some forward-thinking people and places are already doing so, and it is crucial for the rest of us to join them. As the stories that follow show, issues that affect wildlife also affect people, and decisions made in one city influence what happens in other cities and regions, including in far-off nature preserves and wilderness areas. The choices we make today will affect wildlife and shape ecosystems, in cities and beyond, for generations to come. 1. Hotspots. Ecologists love nature reserves, places where people are visitors, wild animals roam free, and ecosystems still seem, at least on the surface, relatively intact. Yet, in an era when humans are transforming almost every aspect of the natural world, such places are increasingly the exception, not the rule. For a different way to understand wildlife in the 21st century, you don't need to travel to some distant mountain range or remote wilderness area. Instead, take a free 25-minute ride on the Staten Island Ferry. Heading south from the Whitehall Terminal in Lower Manhattan, the ferry plies some of the most urban waters on our planet. To the north loom the Financial District skyscrapers, including the fraught monolith of One World Trade Center. To the west stand the Statue of Liberty and Ellis Island. To the east sit the partly artificial landmass of Governor's Island, and beyond it, the Port of New York and New Jersey's giant Red Hook shipping terminal. Look closer, though, at the leafy hills of Brooklyn's Greenwood Cemetery, or out past the Verrazano Narrows toward Lower Bay and the Atlantic Ocean, and you will see the traces of a once great ecosystem. Look even closer, down into the milky blue waves for the humpback whales and harbor seals that in recent years have returned to these waters after long absences, or upward at the gulls, terns, and ospreys circling in the sky overhead. And you may catch glimpses of its partial return. Prior to European contact, the place we now call New York City teemed with life. The island of Manhattan alone, according to the ecologist and author Eric Sanderson, contained an estimated 55 distinct ecological communities, more than a typical coral reef or rainforest of equivalent size. Its meadows, marshes, ponds, streams, forests, and shorelines housed between 600 and 1,000 plant species and between 350 and 650 vertebrate animal species. Early visitors and settlers marveled at New York's wildlife. David Peters DeVries, writing around 1633, counted foxes in abundance, multitudes of wolves, wildcats, squirrels, black as pitch and gray flying squirrels, beavers in great numbers, minks, otters, polecats, bears, many kinds of fur-bearing animals. Others complained of chirping birds and croaking frogs so loud that it was difficult for a man to make himself heard. Yet this racket was a mere inconvenience. According to the 17th century politician and businessman Daniel Denton, New York's rich land and temperate climate ensured the health both of man and beast. Compare colonial New York to Americans' current benchmark for wild nature, Yellowstone National Park. Congress established Yellowstone, the world's first national park, in 1872, to protect its scenery and wildlife, and to attract tourists to an area that, unlike New York, had few other economic prospects. Yellowstone is now a United Nations Biosphere Reserve and World Heritage Site, drawing more than 4 million visitors annually, roughly the same number of people who live in Manhattan and Brooklyn combined. It is one of America's greatest wilderness wonderlands. It is also one of the few areas in the lower 48 U.S. states that retain their full suite of native fauna, from wolverines, grizzly bears, and lynx, to bighorn sheep, mountain goats, elk, moose, pronghorn, and bison. Yellowstone may be a paradise for ecologists. Since 1970, it has accounted for more than one-third of all the published peer-reviewed articles based on research conducted in the national parks. But it is no picnic for most of the creatures that actually live there. With its frigid winters, short growing seasons, and rocky, acidic, nutrient-poor soils, the park can be a tough place to live, especially compared to the rich, temperate, and sheltered landscapes and waterways that once defined the area we now know as New York City. Prior to the 19th century, almost all of the big wild species in Yellowstone also inhabited places that were wetter, milder, more productive, and richer in resources. In such areas, these creatures often had larger populations and required smaller home ranges to meet their needs. Most of them remain in the park today not because it is their ideal habitat, but because people have protected it and because they have few other places to go. Yellowstone remains a land of immense natural value. Yet it is so important not because nature endowed it with biological diversity, but rather because people chose to protect it. The numbers say it all. Prior to European contact, Manhattan, an island of just 23 square miles, contained roughly the same number of species as now live in Yellowstone National Park, a vast region of mountains, valleys, forests, and prairies covering some 3,500 square miles. This means that the Manhattan of yesteryear housed around 150 times more plant and animal species per land area than the Yellowstone of today. If European settlers had wanted to save North America's wildlife instead of getting rich from harvesting it, they would have built a great city in northwest Wyoming and set up a national park at the mouth of the Hudson River. There are several reasons why New York contained such a riot of life. For 2.5 million years, glaciers sheared its cliffs, rounded its hills, tilled its soils, and polished its bedrock, leaving a varied landscape. Located at the boundary between the Mid-Atlantic region and New England, it was a biological crossroads where northern and southern species overlapped and mingled. It also straddled contrasting habitats in a place where salt water met fresh water and land met sea. Nutrient-rich runoff from the Adirondack Mountains flowed into a vast estuary where it circulated with the tides, fertilizing plants, and feeding animals while supplying sediment for mudflats, wetlands, and beaches. Humans also had a crucial role to play. For thousands of years, the Lenape people and their predecessors hunted, gathered, and fished in the area. They stewarded and shaped the land, setting fires to clear brush, stimulate plant growth, and create wildlife habitat, while moving seasonally to harvest resources and find shelter. Archaeologists used to think that the coastal Lenape, like their inland Algonquian relatives, relied on staple crops such as squash and maize. Yet more recent work suggests that, in the area that became New York City, natural resources were so abundant that the prosperous locals had little need for crops. Though gardens were common, they supplied less than 20% of the calories people consumed. The rest came from their ecosystem. The Dutch, who arrived in New York in 1609 and settled in 1624, also found the area to their liking. With its timber for shipbuilding, fish for catching, furs for trapping, and whales for harvesting just offshore, it contained the raw materials to fuel an early modern capitalist economy. These settlers quickly grasped that the area's central location, inland river access, and deepwater port could make it an ideal site for gathering resources and trading with indigenous and European partners. New York soon emerged as a center of North American and transatlantic commerce. By the time of the first U.S. Census in 1790, it had become America's most populous city. New York may seem exceptional. New Yorkers certainly think so. But it is far from unique in its ecological richness. Many of the biggest cities in the United States are located on sites that, prior to their founding, were unusually biologically diverse and productive compared with their surrounding regions. They were also crawling with wildlife. Several factors explain this pattern of overlapping ecological richness and urban growth. Some cities emerged on the sites of indigenous settlements that were well-positioned to access food, water, and other resources. In California, for example, beginning in 1769, Spanish-speaking priests, soldiers, and bureaucrats established a chain of missions along the coast and in nearby valleys. These colonial outposts were built next to indigenous communities, which benefited from their site's agreeable climates, diverse fish and game, staple food plants such as oaks, and year-round access to fresh water, a rarity in much of that arid region. After Mexico achieved independence in 1821, pueblos formed around the old missions, later becoming farming towns and eventually cities. California's four biggest cities, Los Angeles, San Diego, San Francisco, and San Jose, all share these indigenous, mission, and pueblo roots. Los Angeles deserves special mention because of its well-documented ecological history. When the Padres founded their missions at San Gabriel and San Fernando, they had no idea that just 15 miles away and a century later, farmers, oil workers, and eventually paleontologists would discover one of the world's greatest troves of fossils, covering the past 50,000 years. Formed from the same deposits that fueled Southern California's early 20th century oil boom, the La Brea tar pits have produced more than 3 million fossils, including the remains of around 200 vertebrate animal species. A list of the entombed includes extinct behemoths like Colombian mammoths and giant short-faced bears, as well as current stalwarts like skunks and coyotes. These creatures were there for a reason. The Los Angeles Basin offered a mild climate and diverse habitats that supported a spectacular profusion of wildlife. Even after most of the basin's megafauna disappeared, by the end of the last ice age, it remained a kind of American Serengeti. Los Angeles, like New York, was a hotspot of biological diversity. Even where indigenous communities were small or absent, American cities tended to develop in areas that provided settlers with easy access to rich natural resources. Some cities developed right on top of those resources, whereas others emerged close enough to serve as supply hubs. Others formed in strategic locations where their residents could gather or process resources from vast regions. Montreal and St. Louis started as fur trading posts. Denver served as a transit point and supply depot for mining in the nearby Rockies. Chicago became America's greatest 19th century boom town by raking in the West's bounty of timber, beef, and grain. Many large American cities developed on sites with access to water for transportation. Harvesting natural resources doesn't do you much good if you don't have a means to bring them to market. Most of this country's oldest and biggest metropolises sprouted up by the seashore, and more than half of all Americans still live within 50 miles of an ocean coastline. Protected estuaries with high ground for building and deep water for shipping have worked well as city sites. Cities not located on coastlines are often connected to them by navigable inland waterways. Pittsburgh and Minneapolis are obvious examples. Coastlines and rivers corridors are not only favored spots for cities, they also tend to attract a lot of wildlife. This is especially true for river mouths and deltas, which pack diverse habitats into small areas, are highly productive, and provide crucial pathways for migrating fish, marine mammals, and birds. Cities like Sacramento and New Orleans now occupy many of these soggy landscapes. A reliable source of potable water was often a crucial factor in determining the location of a settlement. Consider the example of Phoenix, America's fifth largest and second driest major city. Some 2,000 years ago, the Hohokam built canal systems, farms, and thriving villages along the Salt River. Later native peoples repurposed much of this infrastructure, creating vibrant societies of their own. An 1867 account of the valley described a sparkling stream the year-round, its banks fringed with cottonwood and willow, the land level and susceptible of irrigation. The evidences of a prehistoric race were everywhere in evidence. A carpet of annual grasses, providing a most excellent fodder for stock, covered the higher ground. This water and forage attracted diverse wildlife, including hundreds of migratory bird species. Aquatic animals such as beavers, and grazers like elk and antelope, not to mention the wolves, pumas, and jaguars that hunted them. The desert city of Phoenix now sprawls over this once lush and well-watered landscape. Other cities developed on sites that are often inconveniently wet. Miami is blessed with access to vast wetlands, forests, and the only coral reefs in the contiguous United States. But it is cursed with water lapping at its borders on four sides. To its east is the Atlantic Ocean. To its west is the Everglades. From the sky above comes the wet, subtropical weather that makes it America's second rainiest big city. And below is porous limestone that is filling up with salt water as the sea level rises. Houston grew into a major metropolis after the great Galveston storm of 1900 drove Gulf Coast development inland. Decades of reckless construction then left what is now the country's fourth biggest city vulnerable to a series of floods, culminating in 2017 with Hurricane Harvey. Wetlands that had been converted into reservoirs and later into subdivisions filled with water, pushing thousands of snakes, alligators, raccoons, and other creatures into suburban neighborhoods and reminding Houstonians, at least for a few days, that they still lived in the bayou. Even many cities that appear to have no good ecological reason to be where they are still often seem to be located in oddly biodiverse areas. Las Vegas's very existence depends on vast quantities of water and power from the Colorado River and cheap desert land provided by the U.S. government. Few places so emphatically stand for the plastic antithesis of wild nature, yet Las Vegas has an astonishing natural history, unlike that of any other big city in the United States. Its name, in Spanish, refers to the lush meadows that once blanketed its valley floor. It has a drier climate than Phoenix, but prior to its development, the Las Vegas Valley had some of the most reliable freshwater sources in the Mojave Desert, courtesy of the nearby Spring Mountains. Clark County, where Las Vegas is located, contains 18 ecological communities and at least 233 protected species or species of concern, including some that exist nowhere else, making it a neon red hotspot of biological diversity. All of this adds up to a striking pattern. In the United States, major cities are disproportionately located on sites with high natural levels of biological diversity. As of 2020, 14 of the 50 largest U.S. cities occupied areas of very high biological diversity, even though such areas made up less than 2% of the U.S. land base. These areas serve not only as homes for resident animals, but also as stopovers for traveling creatures. Many birds migrate on paths known as flyways, which parallel mountain ranges or follow river valleys or coastlines. At least 40 of the 50 largest U.S. cities are located within the narrow bands of North America's seven major flyways. More than 260 species of birds migrate through Manhattan, for example, making Central Park a celebrated, if unlikely, birdwatching destination. This pattern extends beyond the United States, though it applies less in some regions than in others. Throughout the world, big cities contain disproportionate shares, given their land areas, of the total biodiversity in the countries where they are located. In Europe, the continent with the best-studied urban ecosystems, cities house at least 50% of most countries' species, even though they rarely cover more than 30% of the land. This pattern probably does not hold for most of the tropics, but even there, one can find tantalizing examples of the overlap between biodiversity and urbanization in places like central Mexico and the Atlantic coastal forest of Brazil. Scholars have been slow to grasp this phenomenon. Until the past couple decades, most ecologists ignored cities, preferring to work in the Yellowstones of the world. Sociologists described future city sites as blank slates. Economists saw in these sites only raw materials or strategic trading posts. Anthropologists emphasized the indigenous cultures of future city sites over their ecosystems, as if the two were unrelated. And historians stressed the unlikely locations of some cities, as well as the eccentric personalities and chance events that led cities to flourish or decline. Geography, they were all quick to point out, is not destiny. Yet, geography does matter. Attributes such as protected coastlines, navigable rivers, potable freshwater, varied habitats, and raw materials were often found in areas of high biological diversity and productivity. These features sustained large numbers of wild creatures, provided the resource bases on which native cultures flourished, and attracted Europeans who built settlements, some of which grew into great cities. City sites started with abundant wildlife, but they didn't stay that way. Cities have complex effects on the landscapes and waterscapes where they develop. As they grow, they add to local biodiversity by importing species and by creating new habitats that attract others. But they also harm native species by harvesting large numbers of useful animals, killing undesirable ones, and destroying or rearranging entire ecosystems, both near and far. These forms of ecological damage characterized even the early days of American urban life, beginning in the 17th and 18th centuries, and then accelerated in the 19th century with industrialization, globalization, and urban population growth. Fertile ecosystems that had attracted settlers decades earlier cracked and buckled. These processes unfolded at different times in different places, but by the second half of the 19th century, areas in and around many American cities, which had once been among the most biologically diverse and productive places on the planet, had lost much of their native wildlife. The loss of wildlife in densely settled areas of North America was part of a larger process that had begun centuries earlier in Europe. By the late medieval period, hunters had depleted wild game across much of Europe, leading wealthy landowners to create private preserves and issue oppressive decrees that imposed severe penalties on violators. Food species such as deer and aurochs, a type of large wild cattle, and fur-bearing mammals like beavers and foxes, disappeared from many places. Deforestation leveled the habitats of woodland species, and predator control efforts cleared the countryside of wolves, wolverines, bears, lynx, and jackals. Aquatic species also suffered catastrophic losses. Prior to 1000 CE, most of the fish consumed in Europe were local varieties, such as pike, perch, and trout, found in freshwater streams or coastal seas. In the centuries that followed, the Norse, English, Scottish, and Dutch reached farther into the North Atlantic, netting enormous hauls of cod, mackerel, and menhaden. These protein-rich food fish, easily preserved by salting or drying, transformed economies, connected distant regions, and fueled population growth, creating a feedback loop that increased demand. By the mid-19th century, most of the great North Atlantic fisheries had collapsed. Populations of marine mammals and seabirds also plummeted as hunters sought out their eggs, skins, blubber, and meat. By 1600, the European onslaught had washed ashore in North America. beaver's plush pelts, strong and pliable enough to withstand the felting process, attracted French, British, and Dutch trappers and traders, funded a diverse indigenous workforce, fueled a globalizing economy, and forged new political alliances. Soon, trappers started bringing other pelts to market: fox, raccoon, mink, fisher, deer, and eventually bison and Pacific sea otter. The fur trade did not cause any species to go extinct, but in their rush to thwart competitors and supply urban markets, trappers and traders cleared vast regions of North America. The wild creatures that remained found themselves confined to dwindling and deteriorating ecosystems. Loggers and farmers followed the trappers, felling, hauling, and milling trees, and clearing fields for crops and livestock. Wild creatures considered threats to economic progress were blacklisted, persecuted, and driven into the most remote corners of their ranges. Northeastern forests were among the first ecosystems to feel these pressures on a large scale. Between 1600 and 1900, New England's tree cover dropped from more than 90 to less than 60% of the land area. Some species that thrived in more open landscapes benefited, but those adapted to living in forests saw their numbers plummet. Lakes and streams were hit even harder than forests. Logging and farming muddied once clear waters, organic runoff fed algae blooms, and dams blocked migrating fish. Industries like tanning flushed nutrients, metals, and chemicals into streams. Untreated sewage flowed freely. Wetlands were drained and estuaries filled. Coastal pollution choked marine life, forcing fishers to travel farther in search of healthy stocks and giving local residents pause about consuming food harvested from toxic waters. Things were little better at sea. Migrating fish like salmon were obliterated in many areas. By the late 19th century, marine mammals, once abundant in the waters around Boston, New York, Seattle, and San Francisco, were all but gone. Atlantic gray whales, walruses, northern elephant seals, and sea otters vanished from entire regions. Southern right whales, California sea lions, gray seals, and several fur seal species hung on throughout their ranges, but in deeply diminished numbers. Although much of this devastation unfolded outside urban areas, demand for marine animal products, from fish for eating to whale oil for lighting street lamps, increasingly came from cities. By the late 19th century, the populations of dozens of wildlife species in the United States had crashed compared to their pre-colonial sizes, with some reaching all-time lows. Many of these species would eventually return to cities like New York, but only after a long period when domesticated animals ruled the urban wild. 2. The Urban Barnyard. It was a scene out of the 19th century in the heart of 21st century New York. Just before noon, on October 17, 2017, a young bull.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.